My name is Art Taylor. I'm a professor here in the English department at George Mason University. I've known Sarah Weinman for many years now and admired her work for many years even before meeting her in person as both a critic, as an editor, as a writer of fiction, and now, most recently, as a writer of book-length nonfiction. In addition to the book we'll be talking about today, The Real Lolita, A Lost Girl, An Unthinkable Crime, and a Scandalous Masterpiece, Sarah was also the editor of the anthology Troubled Daughters, Twisted Wives, Stories from the Trailblazers of Domestic Suspense. It's a text I actually use in my classrooms regularly. And she edited the two-volume Library of America anthology, Women Crime Writers, Eight Suspense Novels of the 1940s and 1950s. Please join me in welcoming Sarah to George Mason and Fall for the Book.
Thank you so much, Art. That was a wonderful introduction. And thank you all for being here. I have a minor programming note. As you can see from the display up there, that's the hardcover cover, which I love. But publishing being what it is, we wanted to reimagine the cover a little bit, which is why also the subtitle changed. So normally at a panel, it's really bad form to hold up the book, but I'm going to do it anyway because this is the new cover with the new subtitle, and there's also a new afterword, which I'll hopefully get into a little bit in our discussion today.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Yeah, you know, looking at obviously the, you're talking a little bit about the book being in hardcover, the book being in paperback now with the new afterword. I remember when we first talked about this project, and it was back in 2014, if I remember correctly, when the essay in Hazlitt first came out. I'm curious, just looking back that far, what was it that first drew you to this story, this project, and can you tell us about the movement from article to book?
Yeah, so I think I first started thinking about this as a project probably sometime in late 2013. I had just come off doing a piece for the New York Times Magazine about a man who was then and now incarcerated for life, who had won a private detective novel contest. And that's the kind of crime feature stories that I write, where they sort of intersect with larger cultural things. So I was casting about for my next story. And as is my wont, it's late at night and I'm on the internet and I am falling down the rabbit hole of the evening, this message board here, this particular website there. And somehow I end up at a link for an essay that had been published in the Times Literary Supplement in 2005 called What Happened to Sally Horner? And it was by a scholar of the writer Vladimir Nabokov who made the connection between Lolita and this real-life kidnapping of a girl named Sally Horner in 1948. And in that essay, he explicitly talks about this line late in the novel when the protagonist, Humbert Humbert, who is, of course, one of literature's most deeply unreliable narrators, he has come back essentially to the scene of the crime in the novel. After Dolores Hayes, the 12-year-old girl that he had repeatedly raped and defiled, is long out of the picture, but he's back, and he's sort of wandering around. And at one point, there's a parenthetical that says, had I done to Dolly, Dolly being Dolores Hayes or Lolita, had I done to Dolly, perhaps, what Frank LaSalle, a 50-year-old mechanic, had done to 11-year-old Sally Horner in 1948. And I'd read Lolita at 16, which I think looking back, I was a little bit young to read Lolita. I'd say probably wait till college. Although one thing about being on the road with this book is that I've heard from many people who not only read it in their teens, but even younger at 12, wow. Which I think is just—
way too young.
It's a lot. So, but I was a precocious child who thought that I could handle it. And I remember even all the way back then, realizing upon reading Lolita that this was just something completely different that I'd never experienced before in literature. And even though it disturbed me, but it also thrilled me, and I just wanted to kind of understand what was going on here, but I had some trepidation about revisiting the novel. And seeing this, I was like, I didn't know there was a real life kidnapping, a real life girl who may have been an inspiration, and I wanted to find out more. So I thought, how could I find out more about Sally Horner's story? Could I report it out? Could I find people who were still alive who may have known her, who were family or friends, or part of law enforcement somehow, because with this kidnapping happening in 1948, which is a little over 70 years ago now, it's just at the bounds of direct experience and memory, but it's also at the juncture where we're starting to lose it. And we're seeing it with a lot of like World War II mm-hmm. narratives and veterans dying off, or people who have experienced genocide and trauma who are also starting to die off. So it's that 20th century, mid-century experience that we no longer have direct experience of. And it was a real challenge for me to try to figure out if I could capture some of that. So I started out reporting it as a piece for a Canadian magazine called Hazlitt. And I started at the beginning of 2014, and I spent a lot of that year researching and reporting it out. And what I learned was that Sally Horner at 11 had been kidnapped by a man who called himself Frank LaSalle. Turns out that wasn't potentially his real name, and he used a lot of aliases. And he took her on a cross-country nightmare from Camden, New Jersey, to Atlantic City, to Baltimore, to Dallas, and then eventually to San Jose, California, where she was rescued. Unfortunately, she only lived another 2.5 years, and it was upon her death in a car accident that Nabokov read an article, and he learned about it.
Yeah. You've got, and already I think people who maybe haven't read the book are seeing there are two strands to this story. There's actually three. I'll get to the third in a moment. But two strands here. One is to do the research into Sally Horner, her abduction, her rescue, her life, her larger life. And the other is, you know, diving into Nabokov's book, the creative process, the writing of it, the publishing of it, the reception of it. Obviously, you know, I mentioned before in the introduction that you are a critic as well, so part of textual analysis is part of what you do. How is the research different going out into the world, looking at this 70-year-old story, versus diving back into a book and then researching that book and everything behind it?
I mean, ultimately, I think what connects them is just the nature of research itself. Mm-hmm. So for Sally's story, it was a combination of looking through old newspaper articles, and I found especially local papers like the Camden Evening Courier and the Courier Post and the Philadelphia Inquirer. And I have to, like, I joke that I really should have devoted an entire section of the acknowledgments to a combination of newspapers.com and ancestry.com, because without them, I would not have been able to write this book at all. And just being able to access these old newspaper articles that had been digitally uploaded saved me so much time, even though I am a microfilm nerd and I'm happy to do that up to a point. Mm-hmm. But it saved a lot of time and energy to just be like, I can load up this newspaper article and call it up and sift through and figure out which parts of these pieces are actually accurate, because sometimes there'd be a lot of misinformation or reporting wrong heights and dates and names, and then trying to just figure all that out. But it was also not just looking at newspaper articles, but I tried to access court documents, although that proved a little bit difficult because, again, late 40s, early 50s, a lot of places just didn't retain records in the way that we might think or expect now. So I remember this one day being in Camden, it was a rainy afternoon. I had taken the train to Philadelphia doing some research, and then I took PATCO, which is a connecting train across the river. And I just basically went from one courthouse to another, to another, to another, just being like, do you have any files? And it didn't exactly pan out, although I got close, but I could still figure enough out. And so that there was that, but also just being able to talk to real people who knew her. So some really indispensable sources to me were Sally's niece, Diana, mm-hmm. who I'm still in sporadic touch with. You know, I'd let her know that the paperback is out, and it was a real privilege and honor to be able to give her a copy of the hardcover, because she didn't really know her aunt. She was only 4 when Sally died, so all she really remembered were pictures, of which I'm going to show one.
Okay.
So that was Sally at 9. So if you see the hardcover, if you see the paperback, that's the same picture. So Sally's brother-in-law, Diana's father, Al, took that picture when she was like 9-ish, 10, so before. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so just being able to have lectures and direct interviews. There was another one that I did with a woman named Carol Starts, who was Sally's best friend mm-hmm. in the last year of her life. So that's sort of the Sally element. It's a mixture of, I guess, investigation and research and reporting. And with the Nabokov stuff, a lot of it was going into his archives, which are at the Library of Congress here in Washington, D.C., as well as the Burr Collection at the New York Public Library, and being able to either look at stuff on microfilm or actually handle like his diaries or a weird folder of ephemera relating to Lolita and its cultural afterlife, like news clippings from tabloids relating to the run-up to the 1962 film by Stanley Kubrick, and me thinking, why did the Nabokovs, because it wasn't just Vladimir's archive, it was also his wife Vera, who was instrumental in essentially creating the mythos mm-hmm. of Nabokov, the genius author. So I was like, why are they keeping like clippings of Sue Lyon grocery shopping, but they don't have anything in relation to Sally Horner at all? And so going through those archives, in addition to reading secondary sources like Brian Boyd's masterful two-part biography and Stacy Schiff's biography of Vera, it really helped me in sort of figuring out the sort of overall timeline of what Nabokov was doing at any given point. So I would try to twin it. So if Sally was taken in 1948, where was Nabokov in 48? If she was rescued in 1950, where was Nabokov at that point? And then in 52, and I'll just jump ahead a little bit here. That was Sally. So those are reproductions of the note cards. So Nabokov had read about Sally Horner's death in an AP wire piece. Still trying to ascertain exactly which one. There are a couple of candidates, but he was on the road because Nabokov would spend summers hunting for butterflies. That was his main hobby. So he would teach at first Wellesley and then Cornell and then go out on the road on these road trips. He didn't drive, by the way, so emotional labor by his wife or a student or his son. So there's that. But to actually see Sally Horner's name in Nabokov's handwriting right there was pretty remarkable. So just to be able to reproduce that and sit with that was a big thing.
You talk about availability of information or misinformation that is in journalistic reports. You talk about going into the archives at the Library of Congress, but there's another, and about finding the name here, yeah. as you pointed out, but there's another layer that you get into in the book about the, you know, both Nabokov and his wife Vera and the construction of both the mythos of the author and the mythos of the book and the fact that they did not say that Sally Horner was an influence, despite the fact that you see this. That's a lot to wade through as well, that reluctance to say any sort of real life connection. How did you, that's part of the literary analysis, yeah. I guess. How did you work with that?
I mean, the first thing is, if there isn't an influence, why is it expressly mentioned in the novel? And one of the literary conceits of Lolita is that it's done in a style where Humbert's actual narrative is what he wants you, the reader, to think, and what he wants you, the reader, to believe is happening. And the parentheticals, like the one about his mother dying, which is picnic lightning, which aside from being just one of the most succinct ways of describing anyone dying, is just like, it's amazing. But those parentheticals are what are as close to the truth of his mind as possible. So the fact that this line that I quoted before about Sally Horner is in a parenthetical was quite telling. So there's another part in the book, because I had mentioned this essay from 2005, but that scholar, Alexander Dolonin, was not the first one to make the connection between Sally's kidnapping and ordeal and Lolita. That was a man named Pete Welding, who later became a rather well-known jazz producer, and he at the time was freelancing for Downbeat, and one of the places he freelanced for was a men's magazine called Nugget, which at the time the editor was affiliated with the Beats and was a writer in his own right. That's a whole other point, but And I bring this up only because this book caused me to fall down so many different rabbit holes that sometimes it would be very difficult to climb out of them. Mm. So I read the piece that Welding wrote for this men's magazine, and he made some of the connections that I had already made, and he made some new ones, and he missed some really important ones as well. But another writer for the New York Post read that piece, and then he wrote the Nabokovs, who at the time were living in Switzerland. Lolita had been published a few years back. It was phenomenally successful upon its American publication after a really fraught and complicated publication process, which involved it being published by Olympia Press in France and him getting into fights with the publisher and then getting the rights back, et cetera, et cetera. So this New York Post writer writes the Nabokovs and said, so what's the deal with the Sally Horner kidnapping? And Vera, writing on behalf of her and her husband, writes this extraordinary letter, which I quote in full in the book, because it was too delicious not to. Essentially saying, yes, Sally Horner is mentioned in Lolita, but there were lots of other cases that he drew from, and so on and so forth. So no, she's not the direct inspiration. But again, I say, if she wasn't, why is she mentioned? And this was a thing with Nabokov in general, that what he would say publicly and what was presented as the public face was often at odds with what was actually going on here. So I also bring up the fact that he deeply, harshly criticized certain writers, like Dostoevsky, and yet he would teach them each and every year. Mm-hmm. And I just feel like if you're going to take the time and trouble to teach a writer each and every year, you have to at least be engaged with their work in some ways, and hate reading is just not, you know, that gets old after a while. So clearly there was something going on here. And if I have to come up with an explanation, and that's something that I really try in the book not to be super didactic about or be like, yes, this happened, or A leads to B, mostly because I think Nabokov is too smart for that, and I want to respect that. Like, that just doesn't feel like a good way of engaging with him and his mind and his work. But I also think it's important to be like, yes, he may have been inspired in this great way. It doesn't take away from the genius and the brilliance of his work, and especially from Lolita, that there may have been some real life inspiration. But I also don't want people to forget that there was this real girl. There was this girl named Sally Horner, and she suffered real trauma and real pain and did not have a chance to grow up, and family still love her and miss her and lament the fact that there was this great absence in their lives. And it's important to at least wrestle with the idea that when you make literature out of other people's lives and pain, there is a responsibility and a cost that at least has to be acknowledged.
I know the point you're making there is one that I actually think about as we're doing this conversation. How much time are we spending on Nabokov and Lolita, how much time are we spending talking about Sally Horner? One of the points you make in the book is how easy it is for the book to have eclipsed anything about the actual real life case. I've got one more question about the book, and then I want to look a little more fully at Sally Horner herself. Yeah. And part of this is you said that reading the book when you were 15, 16? 16. 16, disturbed and thrilled, and then you talked about some reluctance kind of to go back into it. What was that experience of rereading it in this new context like? And there's a great part in the book where you talk about it being taught at a prison and the way that the prisoners react to it in different ways than maybe a lit class would react to it. So what was your experience of going back into the book?
It was very strange because even though I knew exactly what the book was describing, and being so immersed in Sally's story made it extra clear that this was a book about a man's deeply disturbing experience of illicit sexual desire for prepubescent girls and essentially the repeated rape of one of them. And yet because of the nature of the narrative, I still found myself being seduced by it because he uses all the techniques of suspense fiction. And essentially, if you want, Lolita can read like a thriller. It can read like, it's a road narrative. So you could, and the way that the language works is it sort of propels you to keep reading and almost like not notice the horror underneath, except for these little signposts there's one point at the end of one, I think the first part, where Humbert Humbert has taken Dolores to the Enchanted Hunter's hotel, and that is where he rapes her, although he, of course, describes it as consensual, that she initiated it. But whenever people bring that up, I always argue, yeah, but we only have his word for it. Mm-hmm. And why should we trust him? Because his account is clearly not trustworthy. And it's very clearly stated at the beginning of the book that this is his account, and it's deeply subjective and deeply flawed, and we have no idea what actually really transpired, but there are lots of clues hidden that suggest the horror and this fictional girl's ordeal. But then there's a line at the end of the book where it's clear something terrible has happened. We, the readers, are smart enough to know what it is. And Humbert Humbert says, but she had no place else to go. And it's just, even now, like, I think about that, and it's chilling, because there's such a truth to that line. And so relating it back to the real case for Sally, the fact that over 21 months she was taken across the country by a known child molester who had served time for the repeated statutory rape of girls between the ages of 12 and 14, although she didn't know that, her mother didn't know that. Information wasn't disseminated in the same way in the late 40s as it might be now. And yet, because she had the appearance of being, people thought that Sally was Frank LaSalle's daughter, that she was out and about, she was in trailer park, she went to Catholic schools. People thought that nothing was amiss, but of course everything was amiss. And she too had no place else to go, because there was psychological manipulation happening, there was coercive control. She had been told that her family didn't love her anymore, that they didn't care, that she was a throwaway. So what does that do to an 11-year-old girl, or an 11, 12, and then eventually 13-year-old girl? And of course, it's that time frame where we have compassion for that experience now, or at least more compassion, maybe not enough. But back then, there wasn't any of that at all.
Mm-hmm. That kind of brings me to a point, talking about the 21 months she was away. And there's, maybe my favorite chapter in the book is chapter 10, Baltimore, and it starts out, here's the point in the narrative where I would like to tell you everything that happened to Sally Horner during that 21 months. The trouble is, I didn't find out all that much. That's a key moment, and I love the way that you handle it by looking at cases before Sally Horner, looking at cases since, and of course, sadly, there are too many that we could name right off the top of our heads. Can you tell me about that decision to turn a research frustration into what strikes me as a real masterful touch here?
Frustration is the key, because that opening of that chapter was born out of absolute frustration. I think it was the third draft of the book when I finally got it. I had turned in a draft to my editors, and they came back and said, essentially, the Sally's portions are pretty strong, but we have to twin it with Nabokov, so I figured out how to do that. But the whole Baltimore thing just completely eluded me, because even though I went to Baltimore, I went back to the neighborhood on the east side where Sally likely had lived, and I found the school grounds. There's a school there, but it's not the same school. And I had essentially data, but I didn't have a narrative. And I tried to put it together, but it just wasn't working. And my editors and I were sort of fighting, and they kept coming back with this note of, you might need to put yourself in the narrative. And I resisted, because I'm like, I already have two parallel narratives. There's enough going on. Do I really need to put myself in here? I don't want to write a memoir. They didn't want me to write a memoir, so that's fine too. But it was like I was banging my head against the wall. And then finally I came up with that line of, you know, here's the part where I tell you. So I thought, okay, I'm going to take a leap here and do something which I feel fundamentally a little bit at odds with, but I need to show the reader what I know, but I also need to show the reader what I don't know, and maybe that will confer an even greater authority in the narrative and in what I do know. So I sort of refashioned the Baltimore idea with, okay, let me take this data that I have and figure out what might be a typical day that Sally Horner would have had while going to school in Baltimore. So at least if I'm doing informed speculation, it's within a very narrow realm, and I'm not trying to write fiction here. What's interesting is that after the book was published, I then got some new material. It's always, and I forgive me for an eye roll here, but it's always interesting when the FBI, after you've sent in a Freedom of Information request 2 years prior, gets back to you 3 weeks before your pub date, and says, here's the file you wanted. It's like, I wonder why. So I got an email saying, we have Frank LaSalle's FBI file. And in that FBI file, it finally confirmed, yes, here was Sally Horner's address in Baltimore. Here are some few other details. What it also did was it solved a problem that I mentioned in the first edition of the book, where I'd been looking for anything about the first 40 years of his life. It had just been completely opaque and completely, it just eluded me. And I was trying to get the help of this archivist, and he was really on board, and he couldn't find anything. We knew that he had served time at a federal prison in Kansas, but I could not figure out the alias. And then I look at the FBI file, and there's the alias. And so what it meant was I now knew what he looked like when he was younger. So I'm going to, hold on. And I don't think I have it. Oh, too bad. I thought I had it in this version, but I don't. In any case, if you check the paperback edition, it will have a picture of younger Frank LaSalle. But in any case, these are the things I was kind of trying to wrestle with, of lack of information or information coming at inopportune times.
Well, also, you know, what's interesting in talking about the earlier abductions, and I'm looking again at chapter 10, you talk about 14 years before Sally Horner's abduction, there was June Robles. And then, of course, more recently, we've got Elizabeth Smart, J.C. Dugard, we've got Ariel Castro and the three women that he kept captive. How did looking at those stories and pulling from what we do know about those stories inform your ability to try to understand Sally Horner? And what's a big gap? I mean, this is like you talk about Lolita being like a crime novel, a thriller. This is like you're a detective and you're filling in what happened by looking at other stories. How did that work?
Well, it would have been amazing if Sally Horner had kept a diary, but she didn't. Or if she did, it was lost to history. So I had no access to her psychological state of being except for what her best friend Carol, who has since passed away, what she told me about knowing Sally in the last year of her life and how much she longed for a sort of normal way of being. There was definitely some struggle with depression, although in 1950 to 52, that's not what they would have called it. She was teased mercilessly at school because at that point, she wasn't looked at as a victim. She was looked at as someone who had willingly given up her virginity to an older man and gone away with him, which itself is just infuriating. And so, I'm sorry, I lost the train of, oh, I see. So, looking at the later cases in particular with Elizabeth Smart and J.C. Dugard and the three women who are known as the Cleveland Three, I wanted to get some psychological insight, and all of them had written records of their captivity. And some captivities, as in Elizabeth Smart's case, lasted about 9 months. In J.C. Dugard's, it was 18 years. So to have that sense, I found extraordinarily helpful. And there was an earlier version of the book where I had much more on that, and I pulled back. And so one of the notes I got was, were there any contemporaneous or earlier situations that paralleled what happened to Sally? And then I found out about this kidnapping of the six-year-old girl, or the disappearance of the six-year-old girl, June Robles. And that itself became a little bit of a weird rabbit hole, because it turned out that no one knew she had died, and only her family had, essentially they had sort of hushed up. It's not that they had hushed up her death, it's just that they didn't want to broadcast. And so I found her death notice, and I happened to know an obit writer at the Times. I thought, well, there was this famous kidnapping, and she died a few years ago, and maybe you can do something with it. And A few weeks later, they did do something with it. And they did reach out, and the family was just baffled, like, why are you interested in this? So there's another mystery with that particular case, which is beyond the scope of the book. But again, there was media coverage, and there was some degree of captivity, and I wonder to what degree that informed her life and the reason why she became such a silent figure for the rest of her life.
Well, one of the things you're touching on here is obviously the different values, responsibilities, et cetera, of different times. You know, there's a time when this is a kind of story that's going to get covered up, and there's a time when this kind of story is be treated in a different way. And we're getting a glimpse at mid-century and before. Yeah. And its values from this. Obviously, we've got a portrait of Sally Horner here, of a childhood that's been taken away, of then, because of the car accident, a life that's cut short. Yeah. This is speculative, but if she had lived longer, you would probably have more information, wouldn't you? I mean, in terms of her having the time to process and to tell that story herself.
Yeah, or if she would have even wanted to. I mean, this is also deeply speculative, but I do know that Sally was bookish. She loved to read. And so my little alternate history is that she somehow would have been able to be alive to read a book like Lolita and experience it for herself, because she did read the bestsellers.
Right.
So this picture here, that's Sally just a few weeks before she went to the seaside town of Wildwood, New Jersey, with her best friend. And she made the mistake of going in a car with a cute boy that she liked. And that's what happened.
Two more questions, one about the times and one about the subtitle or the caption you have here about how she matters then. I teach a true crime class here at Mason, have taught it. We teach the Howard Unruh case in there, which is one that we know about, but you could talk about it a little bit. Still, it sort of surprised me suddenly to realize, oh, wait, that was happening around the same time as this. You've got two crimes here, and I'll let you tell about the Howard Unruh case, two crimes here that seem pivotal and representative of, unfortunately, a lot of different crimes throughout the century. So can you talk a little bit about how this book serves both those crimes and keeping one from overshadowing the other?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, Sally Horner's kidnapping and rescue and its relationship to Lolita, I've gotten a lot of questions about thinking through the Me Too movement and how we handle the stories of girls and women who have been abused and harmed, and trying to make sure that their voices are more prominently heard. And that was obviously why I wrote this book, was because I wanted Sally's story to be out there. I wanted people to know about her. I really believe that she matters, and that it's not just her as an individual person, but she does stand in for everyone who has experienced similar abuse and harm. But then with the Unruh case, and this was not the first American mass shooting, but it's the one that we think of as like the first modern one, because it happened in September of 49 in Camden, New Jersey. So again, something was happening in Camden in post-war America. And Camden itself became a little bit of a character as I was working on this, because it had been such a prosperous manufacturing town. Ships were being built during the war. Campbell Soup was, and technically still is, there. RCA Victor had its offices. There were the record company. But already by the late 40s, early 50s, it was starting its precipitous decline, from which it has struggled and continues to struggle to get out of. And so I just felt like, symbolically, the fact that this Army veteran who had grudges against his neighbors and then woke up one morning and decided to kill a whole bunch of them, and I believe he killed 12 or 13, including some children, just felt felt important to discuss, in part also because the prosecutor who brought Frank LaSalle to justice, Mitchell Cohen, also was pivotal in getting Unruh to confess, and although Unruh was never tried, he spent the rest of his life in a mental institution, it felt particularly important to tell the story. And of course, there's an even more awful coda, because one of the survivors of Unruh's massacre, Charles Cohen, his entire family had been annihilated. His father had been a druggist, who was one of Unruh's main targets and of grievance. Cohen was 12, And he grew up and he married and he had children. And one of his granddaughters survived Parkland. So the fact is now it's not just about one mass shooting, it's about inherited generational trauma. And obviously this happened after I finished the book, but I think about that a lot.
I'm watching the time a little bit.
Sure.
I want to ask one more question that's going to connect a little bit of this and go back to the Sally Horner matter then, and she matters now. This is giving us the behind the scenes of a very famous novel. Do you think that folks who are, say, teaching this novel, literary scholars, are going to come to this book and see something new in a text that they have appreciated, taught, etc.? Do you think that move is going to happen as well, that we'll re-understand the book?
That's already started to happen. I've heard from professors who have been teaching Lolita and my book in tandem, and people, their students are finding all sorts of new ways into the novel. But I expressly wrote my book for not only for people who have read Lolita dozens of times or even a handful of times, but for people who had never read the novel at all, who might not even want to. There are people who have expressly told me, I hate that novel, I never want to read it, I think it's distasteful, but your book was great. And it's like, okay, that's fine too. Because ultimately, yes, it is about the real life case that was an inspiration for a famous novel, but there's a lot more going on about the responsibility of art to real life, what we think about in terms of other people's pain, about America in the mid-century. And I do think a lot about that last one in particular, because we hear a lot about a time when America was supposed to be, quote, great, and in fact, it never was. So I feel like what I'm conveying in this book is more about what actually happened as opposed to the myth-making that we have about this country.
Did you want to show a little bit of this? And
yeah, hopefully this will work. Uh-oh.
Not going further.
Doesn't look like it.
Okay.
That's okay.
All right. I can. The video. We have a short video to show here.
Thank you so much, Juliet, for the AV help. I really appreciate it. There we go. So just to narrate it a little bit, this was a few weeks after Sally Horner's rescue in 1950. And she and her family are at the Philadelphia Zoo. And that's Sally right there. And she's walking with her, there she is. She was walking with her older sister, Susan, who is holding Sally's niece, Diana, who was 2 at the time. And I remember when Diana gave me this clip and I watched it the first time, and every time I watch it, I still kind of get a little bit emotional just to be able to see Sally move and to see her live. So I wanted to end the presentation part with that, and that's Diana right there.
And you had that clip before you before writing the book the first time. This is not something that you discovered after the...
It was while I was writing the book. Probably, I met with Diana at a diner near where she lives in South New Jersey. And I had old newspaper clips and photos that I didn't think she had seen before. And she said, oh, I found these photos and this film clip that my dad had kept. He had passed away in... I think it was early 2016. And so we sort of showed what we had.
Right.
And then I took the clip and plugged it into the computer and started watching and thought, oh my God,
yeah.
It's her, she's real. I mean, I knew she was real, but just to have that, have her up there was just, it made my project more real to me.
It's very different to see the video as opposed to a photograph,
yeah.
In many ways, brings her to life. I'm going to open up for questions now. I will repeat the question if anyone has one. Just raise your hand and let me know. Bob?
You talked about her being rescued in San Jose, I think it was. Who actually did that? How did it happen? Was it the FBI like smashing in on the guy? Or how did this all come about?
I'm going to repeat the question. The question is about the rescue of Sally Horner. In San Jose and how that came about. So here.
So it came about through the efforts of a neighbor of hers at the trailer park in Dallas, where Sally and Frank lived from September of 49 through early March of 1950. And the neighbor's name was Ruth Janish, and she had an extremely complicated, troubling, frustrating life. She was not a great mom. She was not a great wife. She'd had abuse of her own, but she saw something amiss with the relationship between Sally and Frank LaSalle and decided to do something about it. So she and her family were about to migrate to San Jose, and once they got there, she wrote LaSalle a letter saying, there's work to be had here. Why don't you take Sally and move here? So he did, hitched his trailer to a car and drove all the way to California. And one day, a few days after they arrived, he went into town for work. His car had broken down. Sally went over to Ruth's place, and Ruth gently asked her, what's going on? Is Frank your father? And Sally had denied it earlier, but this time she told the truth, and Ruth helped her make a long-distance phone call to her family. So first she tried to reach her mother, and the line was disconnected because Ella, Sally's mother, had trouble keeping a job, and she had been let go, and she didn't have a working telephone. So then Sally tried her brother-in-law and sister at a greenhouse that they operated. And so she reached her brother-in-law, and he was the one who called the FBI, and they descended upon the trailer park, or upon the bus station where LaSalle was getting off, and arrested him. And soon he would be transported back to New Jersey and then pled guilty and spent the rest of his life in prison. So that's what happened.
Yes. This is a stylistic question.
Because the book that I wanted to write was expressly about not only Sally Horner's kidnapping and rescue and ordeal, but also the ways in which that story informed the making and the creation of a famous novel, and what we think about art and literature and what we value. And so it wasn't just that I wanted to tell a story, it was also that I wanted to interrogate certain things about what we value and what we prioritize, and who we prioritize. So I am sure that someone else would have taken that material and written in a completely different book, but they don't have my brain. So with my brain, I wrote the book that I did.
This is, one of the things we're talking about is the tension between a Sally Horner who should not be forgotten, who matters, and all like that. If it hadn't been for Lolita, would she have just, there would not, you wouldn't have gone into this book.
Right, and I have to acknowledge that if there wasn't that particular connection, I might not have been as interested in it, and I am sure that there are other comparable stories that don't have that extra cultural connection that do get forgotten and are erased, and they shouldn't be. I was just telling this particular story because, again, it appeals to all facets of all of the interests that I have as a writer and a journalist and a critic and an editor, and it felt like this is the story I was almost put on this earth to tell. But someone else could have approached it very differently, and that would have been perfectly valid as well.
Other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Did your feelings about Nabokov changed while writing this book?
I'm going to repeat.
I know they were good beforehand, but.
I'm going to repeat that one. Did the feeling about Nabokov change over the course of writing the book?
Yeah, it changed several ways. I mean, I went into it knowing something about his writing and his character and his nature and his thinking, but I wasn't steeped in it. I didn't study Russian literature in college. I had read Lolita and Pin and Pale Fire and Speak Memory, but I did a lot more reading of Nabokov's fiction as well as his lectures on literature. So this project actually allowed me to really get to know Nabokov's writing in a way that I think I never would have before. And I respected him, but I felt very distant. And I felt like working on my book helped me understand him a little bit more as a human being, and to see him as more of a moral writer than I think people give him credit for. But I also don't want to let him off the hook either. And what I can say is that I sit here before you, and I still would call Lolita one of the greatest novels written in the 20th century, even after writing The Real Lolita. So in that respect, it didn't alter my reading relationship with Nabokov at all. I still think Lolita is great literature, but I also will never read it and not think of Sally Horner.
Claire.
So in the end, where do you come down on this question of using cases like Sally Horner's to inspire fiction? I mean, did you ever think about writing a novel about Sally yourself? If someone did write a novel about Sally, what would you want it to be like?
The question is about where do you come down on the idea of using real life stories to inspire fiction, and if that's right.
I don't have a simple answer, and I don't think I should have a simple answer, because I've written fiction that's been inspired by real life cases. And similarly, there is a novel that was published last year that is essentially a novel about Sally Horner, which I had, you can read my thoughts in a piece I wrote for Vanity Fair. I think that's okay. Sort of my first and last word on that. Ultimately, I feel like it's important to have a complex relationship, because this is, you know, we're dealing with real life instances of pain and trauma. And what I have found after writing this book, working on other crime features, working on my new book, is I'm getting more sensitized to that. And I think that's a good thing. I feel like it wasn't that I was desensitized before, but I just feel ever more mindful and ever just this feeling of I have to take care to get it right as much as possible, even while knowing that it's an inherently risky thing. I mean, what Nabokov did with Lolita, like that's sort of the degree of difficulty that we should all aspire to in terms of creating great literature out of real life inspiration. And most of us are not going to get there. We're all going to fail pretty hard. But at least we should try to sort of take a step back and go, what is it that I really want to accomplish with this work of art that I am creating? And who will benefit, but also who may suffer? And it doesn't mean you should stop. It just means the more that we spend time thinking and pondering and sitting with our own moral culpability and our own responsibility, I think the better off we all are, even if we may not ultimately be super successful at it. I think one of the things too, and this is why the current moment of true crime is really fascinating and in many ways quite wonderful right now, is that there are so many more writers who are grappling with these really complex questions in their works and coming up with new ways of figuring it all out and coming up with stories that aren't just about great yarns, that actually grapple with something a lot more meaningful.
Yeah. All right, a question right here.
I have a question for actually both of you, who is an English teacher and you as the writer of the book. You mentioned that it has changed the way people are approaching Lolita, and you said even using your book and Lolita together. So how is that happening? I mean, what are some of the differences, the key differences that you can see and hear and experience?
Okay, the question is about how knowing the background of the story, how it does change the way that you encounter a text and teach a text. Sarah?
I think what's been conveyed to me is just that teaching Lolita and my book in tandem actually makes students a little bit more receptive to what's going on in Lolita. It's a novel that I think a lot of young people, at least to the best of my knowledge, either don't want to wrestle with at all, or they have deeply complicated feelings, or they might need some sort of trauma warning to deal with it. And so having another conduit is proving to be helpful. Now, I'll be interested to see how that plays out over the life of my book and how much more it is taught in classrooms. Later this year, I'm going to be guest lecturing at a couple of university lectures, a couple of classes to talk about this very question. So perhaps I'll be able to report back at a later point.
Sure. I've never taught Lolita, so I can't really talk about that text in particular. Just this week, though, Women of Mystery class here at Mason, we taught Laura Lippman's Lady in the Lake, which is actually inspired by, I won't say based on, but was inspired by two events in Baltimore in 1969. One was the murder of Esther Leibowitz, who was a young girl, and also the murder of an African-American waitress, Shirley Parker. We didn't spend a lot of time in class talking about how that all works together. It was more like, this is the story behind it, and then let's look at how the novelist has transformed this story into something else. I think one of the good things about Laura Lippman's book goes exactly what Sarah Wyman's talking about here in terms of, you know, grappling with some moral questions, grappling also with a portrait of the times and what the values of the times were and how those values have changed to now. As Laura said, you know, she was very aware at 10 years old of Esther Leibowitz's story. She did not know Shirley Parker's story, and that was partly because of race issues at the time. Today she's telling that story in a different way, a different story in a different way. And I've taught other things. One that pops to mind, Lewis Norden's Wolf Whistle, is inspired by the murder of Emmett Till. And it's a brilliant book. It is not about Emmett Till, but you will understand Emmett Till's case better from looking at Lewis Norden's book. And I think that's the power of art. Checking the time, we have time for one more question. Yes, ma'am.
Speaking to what you had talked about earlier about losing voices during the 20th century, the individuals that you did get in touch with, how did you approach them so that they were willing to talk about such dark trauma, as well as kind of display, you know, gain their confidence and display your desire to report this in a respectful manner?
Okay, I'm going to repeat the question. These voices who are coming back to a story that's 70 years old, how did Sarah approach these folks, gain their trust, and get them to revisit this dark time, Sarah?
It's a tricky question because it varied depending on what sort of contact information I was first able to obtain. So in a couple of instances, I basically had to cross my fingers and cold call, which it still makes me break out in hives to do that, and I've done this for many years now. And then I'd be like, please go to voicemail, please go to voicemail. So then I would leave the voicemail and just explain, hi, you know, I'm a writer in New York and I'm working on this book project, and it's about Sally Horner, who I believe you knew or was related to you, and I'd love to talk to you more, and then have sort of a not an informal conversation, but just one on background where it wasn't necessarily on the record. But then there was one instance with Carol, Sally's best friend in the last year of her life, where I had been looking for her for years. And it, because she had married several times, it was really just triangulation of certain databases. And I finally found the name and a number. And I called it thinking it probably would not work. And she picked up. So I was like, well, I guess I'm in it now. So I said who I was, and she paused and said, you mean my friend Sally inspired the novel Lolita? And I said, yeah, let's talk about that. And we had a couple of wonderful phone conversations, and she was very generous and forthcoming, and we emailed several times. And then unfortunately, her health was already not very good, and she passed away, but it's always been such a privilege and honor to talk to people who will give their time. There's another instance in the book when I interviewed a source who is pseudonymous, who had also experienced serious abuse and PTSD. And I did not get in touch with her right away. I was in contact with a sibling, and I waited and I waited, and then I just sort of had to take the leap and called her, and again left a message, and she did call back, but she didn't, and I could tell that she wanted to talk, but she didn't want to talk on the phone. And I said, I'm happy to fly out and we can just meet at any place in your convenience. And she said yes, so we arranged for a meeting a few months from then, and I flew out to another part of the country, and we met in a diner, and she talked. And then after talking, we went back to her house, and she talked some more. And then she invited me to dinner, and I looked at her and I said, after what you've told me, I'm exhausted, and I can only imagine how many orders of magnitude it is for you, so why don't we go our separate places and we'll talk again in the morning. And so when I called her the next morning, she thanked me and said, yeah, I really needed that break, and you know, come out to the house and we'll talk some more. And she ended up coming to one of my events, as did Sally's niece Diana to my Philadelphia event. So I feel like they're the people whose opinion matters most. Like what readers have been telling me is incredibly gratifying, and I will continue to be humbled and honored by everybody's responses. And I know that there's been an array of responses, but I wrote a book that I think invites an array of responses. But to know that they have read the book and it means something to them means all that much more to me.
I think that's a good note to end on. We can, of course, continue the conversation just outside. Sarah will be signing copies of the book right out in the lobby just outside, and you're welcome to come and ask some more questions there at that time. Meanwhile, please join me in thanking Sarah Weinman for coming today.
Thank you so much, Art, and thank you all for coming. It was a real pleasure to talk about my book to you all this morning.